coming. Before we start, a few logistic things. So first of all, the Wi-Fi. So if you look at your Wi-Fi port now, so there should be one that is 111, which is one that is next door. It doesn't require a password, so it should be able to connect through 111. And as for dinner, so for the speakers tonight, the talk's in at 6 o'clock. So we'll gather around the 8th floor to leave for dinner around 6:10. So this is an informal dinner. So for those of you who are interested in attending, so please join us in the 8th floor around the elevator, and we'll head out around 6:10. Okay. So is everything okay?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So we'll just start with the talks. So first we have Xu Hen Xiao, then he'll start off this workshop, and he'll tell us about beyond symmetry, topological lines in two dimensions. So please take it.
All right, thank you. Well, first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for putting together this conference. And also for me, it's very special to give a talk here at the same classroom where I learned linear algebra 10 years ago. Okay, so let's get started. So the title today is Beyond Symmetry, Topological Lines in Two Dimensions. And this is based on work with Qingming Chen, Yingxuan Lin, Yifan Wen, and Xiying. The talk will consist of two parts. The first part will be an overview about some basic property of topological lines in two dimensions and some general motivation. At the end of the first part, I will prove a theorem on the normalization rules. And the second part of the talk will be a Blackboard talk, where I will go into more details on the property of the topological kinds. So symmetry has always been a guiding principle in theoretical physics. As we learned from day one of quantum field theory, global symmetry is more powerful in constraining renormalization group flows, correlation functions, and all other physical observables in quantum field theory. This includes topological anomaly matching, which usually gives us a lot of information of what the IR structure of a renormalization group flow could be. This also includes the Ward identity on correlation function, which often is constrained if not determined before. And global symmetries are, of course, also important in checking dualities. More recently, this program has been generalized to higher form global symmetry. These are global symmetries that can be coupled to higher form gauge fields. And the higher form global symmetries have also shown to be very useful in constraining the dynamics of quantum field theory. One invariant characterization of global symmetry is in terms of its charge operator, AKA the topological defect. Topological defect might sound like a fancy word, but it actually isn't. It's something we are mostly familiar with. In the case of continuous global symmetry, the topological defect is nothing but the Noether charge. The Noether charge is supported on a codimension 1 manifold in our spacetime, which is usually taken to be a constant time slice, for example. It's more invariant to think about the Noether charge as a defect operator in our quantum field theory that acts on our local operators. It is topological because the associated Noether current is conserved. Therefore, when you deform the codimension 1 manifold a little bit, that will not change the answer for any physical observables. More generally, any zero-form global symmetry, continuous or not, is associated to a codimension 1 topological defect, which I will denote by L sub G, where G is the group element. And the way that this codimension 1 topological defect acts on local operator is by encircling the local operator here shown as phi. And as you shrink this codimension 1 topological defect to smaller and smaller and smaller, in the process, since it's topological, you don't change the answer at all. When the codimension 1 manifold is extremely small, this will reproduces a local operator for you. In the case when this topological defect is the charge operator of a certain symmetry, this contraction will give you another local operator, that is the that is the symmetry transformation of the original, which I denote by G prime. So all this might sound a little bit fancy, but this is a very invariant and non-Lagrangian way to think about global symmetry in quantum field theory.
When you say topological, if it was another term, it would be integrated over this contour, and so topological would mean that I could do like homology, I could connect and reconnect my...
That's right.
Is that what you mean by topological? Or
that's actually not. So in the case of Noether current, indeed, you can connect and reconnect. But for more general topological effects, that might not be the case. And that's actually a very important distinction of the topological defects that are associated to global symmetry from the more general ones. And hopefully I will talk about that. Okay, so all the previous slides were trying to review the fact that whenever you have a zero-point global symmetry, the most invariant way to think about it is that there's a corresponding codimension one topological defect, namely the charge operator. At this point, it's then natural to ask, is the converse is true? Namely, is every codimension one topological defect in the quantum field theory associated to a certain zero-point global symmetry? And the answer is no. And that's going to be the main focus of the talk today. So the converse error is not true. The slogan of the talk today will be the power of non-symmetry as opposed to the usual power of symmetry. There are codimension one topological defects that are not the charge operators of any global symmetries. I will loosely refer to this codimension one defects as non-symmetric topological defects, although the more technically correct term is that they are the non-invertible topological defect. But here in this talk, I want to make the comparison with the symmetry defect more apparent. So I will call them the non-symmetric topological defects.
Sorry, so how do you classify those things if they are non-charged on the global symmetries?
Right, so that would be
another main focus.
Part of the that would be the main point of the talk. What,
okay.
How do you characterize all this topological?
They're not protected in any sense, either.
Whether or not it's protected, whether or not it's robust under renormalization principles, these are all interesting questions. And hopefully, I will get to answer all of that. If I don't, please remind me, because I do have the answers, I think. And as it turns out, these non-symmetry topological defects are equally powerful in constraining the dynamics of quantum field theory as their symmetry cousins. And we don't have to look far for such defects. At this point, it might seem that these non-symmetry defects are totally exotic and only appear in some very weird makeup of quantum field theory. But in fact, they are ubiquitous, at least in two-dimensional CFT. For example, there's already one such non-symmetry topological defect in the two-dimensional ICC. So here's a little roadmap on how this work fits into the more general program. We are very used to use zero-form global symmetry and its associated symmetry codimension one topological defect to constrain renormalization group flows and all other physical observables. Relatively recently, there has been a lot of development on applying the higher form global symmetry to constrain the dynamics of quantum field theory. And typically, these studies are done in higher than two dimensions, where the higher form global symmetry are more non-trivial. Today, we want to take an orthogonal direction. We will focus on the non-symmetry codimension one defects in two dimensions. So codimension one in two dimensions will mean that there are lines in two dimensions. And they will also prove to be very useful in answering various questions for renormalization rules. So before I go into any details, let me just announce a theorem to begin with. In 2D, if certain, and I will explain certain in the following, in the rest of the talk, if certain non-symmetry topological line is preserved along the RG flow, then the IR theory cannot be trivially down. In other words, if certain non-symmetry topological line is preserved, then the vacuum in the IR cannot consist, cannot be a gap phase with a single vacuum. There are various possibilities. It could be a gap phase with degenerate vacuum, or it could be a gapless CFD. The nature of the theorem is very similar in spirit to Tegucigalpa anomaly matching. Typically, in the UV, if you have a global symmetry that has a Tegucigalpa anomaly, that means in the IR, the theory cannot be trivially down, because there has to be certain degrees of freedom to reproduce the anomaly in the UV.
And can you tell if one of these topological non-symmetry operators is preserved?
Yes, there's a definitive way to say whether a line is preserved or not. Unfortunately, I actually deleted that slide from the talk. I think later on I will say those in words.
So is this theorem or this statement just to do with the fact that a lot of those topologically protected objects, their tension, their masses are related to their charges, some kind of BPS relation, and then you cannot cite to this?
Yeah. If they're topological, they don't have any tension.
Yeah, they're tensionless. It doesn't cost any energy to move them a little bit.
But so it seems like a monopole. They're massive. It's a common, right?
Yeah, but these are not.
Okay.
You can dynamically engineer such
a domain wall does have tension.
That's right. So it's important to distinguish the domain wall from the topological defect. In the UV, you can prepare a domain wall by varying your coefficient or in some ways.
Uh-huh.
In the UV, that would be some finite masses object.
Okay.
But once you flow to the IR, that may or may not become a topological defect.
I see.
So I'll start with some basic property of topological lines. The very first property is that they are topological. Namely, if I deform the line a little bit, like this, without passing through any local operator, then all the physical observables should be invariant.
When you say all physical observables invariant for symmetries, we know what it means for S-metrics. So in this case, what is the statement about S-metrics?
I was thinking about CFD. This talk will mainly about two-dimensional CFD. So the physical observable will mainly be about correlation function of a compact group.
So you talk about FG flows.
Yes, yes.
Oh,
so I will use those topological lines to constrain the endpoints of the RG flows. In quantum field theory, it's a little bit tricky to define all those topological lines, but you could. I think it's a very interesting question to ask how these topological lines are related to the S matrices, say in an integral flow. There seems to be a very deep relation, but we couldn't quite figure it out. At the end of the first part of the talk, I will mention some examples of integral flows and how these topological lines play an essential role. And I would like to see how these topological lines are related to the integral S matrices. But mainly, I will use that to constrain the vacuum structure of the IR theory or correlation functions. The fact that they are topological means that they commute with both the left and the right Virasoro algebra. And that's going to be a key property of the topological line that distinguish themselves from the conformal line or some more general lines. The second basic property of topological lines is the notion of effect Hilbert space. So consider we quantize the theory on this red circle, and we insert the topological line L transversely to this circle, such that the line intersects with the circle at a point. This intersection modifies the Hilbert space. So the state on this red circle will not a priori be related to the ordinary Hilbert space in a straightforward way. This is another Hilbert space that one should specify and study when you encounter a conformal. And I will denote this Hilbert space by H sub L. The subscript reminds you that this is the effect Hilbert space associated to the topological line L. HL might not be isomorphic to the bulk Hilbert space, which are in one-to-one correspondence with the local operator via operator state correspondence. A priori, we don't know much about the defect Hilbert space, but there's one thing we do know. Since the topological line commutes with both the left and the right parasorbic algebra, the defect Hilbert space has to be in representation of both the left and the right parasorbic algebra. In other words, I should be able to decompose my defect Hilbert space into representation of the two parasorbic algebras with a non-negative integer multiplicity for each representation. This is one of the most important property of a topological line, especially the integrality condition here. And that will greatly constrain what kind of topological line you can have in your homology.
Just to understand
yes.
The language, so when this topological line is a shape to usual global symmetry, what is the space?
Oh, very good. Yeah, thank you for asking that. So if the topological line is a symmetry line, then the way it modifies the Hilbert space is that you instead of having fields that are periodic on the circle, the density condition becomes that when it goes around the circle, it's acted by the symmetry. So it becomes the twist is acted. The third basic property of the topological line is that it defines an action on the Hilbert space. This we have already encountered in the introduction part of the talk, where when we talk about the symmetry line. So we can encircle a local operator by our topological line. In the case when it's a symmetry line, L sub G, this, as we contract the circle, this will reproduce for us another local operator that's related to the original one by a symmetry transformation. One key property of this map is that since the topological line commutes with both the left and the right parasorbic algebra, this map preserves the conformal weights h and h bar of the local operator. Namely, the local operator phi bar on the right hand side will have the same conformal weight as the original phi. Furthermore, the map might not be invertible. In the case when it's a symmetry line, it has to be invertible, because the group it always has an inverse element. But more generally, from this abstract definition of the action on local operator, there's no a priori guarantee that the map is invertible. When it is not invertible, it's a hallmark of the fact that the line is a non-symmetry line. And I'll give a simple example of that. So these three are some very basic properties, but there are definitely more properties to topological lines, but these three are the ones that I would need to prove the theorem that I have alluded to.
So, if an invertible topological line operator means it, does that imply that it's topological in the homology sense as opposed to the integer sense?
Yes.
Is that easy to see?
I think that's almost easy, almost obvious, because when it's invertible, that means certain effect Hilbert space between lines is one-dimensional. And the fact that it's one-dimensional will imply that we do crossing, although I haven't talked about crossing, that the possibility on the right-hand side is unique. And that basically means that you can connect it this way. The fact that the non-symmetry line fails to be homological means that when you connect it this way, on the right-hand side, there are multiple channels.
Sure.
And that typically means that the defect Hilbert space is more than one dimension. The one useful characteristic of a topological line in two dimensions is its vacuum expectation value, bracket L. we define such a quantity when the CFP has a unique vacuum and does not has a unique vacuum. And let me call such a vacuum 1. Then the depth of a topological line is defined as the eigenvalue of the line acting on that. There's some small subtlety in this definition when the line is associated to an anomalous global solution. But let me not go into the details of that. This definition might be off by a phase when the symmetry is anomalous, and then you will require more invariant definition. But for the purpose of the talk today, I will not talk too much about anomaly, and this definition will work.
This also doesn't apply quite if there's spontaneous gradient.
That's totally right. So that's why I put an assumption here that there's a unique vacuum. In the case when the symmetry is spontaneously broken, and then this one should be defined as the vacuum in the UV. And that will be the definition we use. When the line is a symmetry line, it's guaranteed that the VEF of the line has to be 1. Because by assumption, the vacuum is invariant under the global symmetry. More generally, the line might have a non-unity VEF. And that's one quick way to see whether the line is a symmetry line or a non-symmetry line. Now let's give some easy construction for topological lines in two-dimensional rational. In a diagonal rational CFP, there's a simple class of topological lines, sometimes under the name of Bernoulli lines. These lines are in one-to-one correspondence with the primary operators. And these lines commute with both the left and the right chiral algebras. So for each primary operator, there's an associated Bernoulli line. This Bernoulli line is sometimes preserve more symmetry than a general topological line because it commutes not only with the Virasoro algebra, but the full chiral algebra. For example, the current algebra in the case of the WTW models. And the Bernoulli lines obey the same fusion rule as their corresponding primary operators. I will not give the details about the construction for such Bernoulli lines in rational CFP. But the way that they are classifying constraint is from the previous condition that we mentioned the basic property of topological line. So let me just restate that. So as we say, one very important property of topological line is that the defect Hilbert space has to fall into representation of both the left and the right Virasoro algebra with non-negative integer multiplicity. That turns out to be an extremely strong constraint topological lines, especially in rational CFP. And it's basically from that integrality condition that you can construct all these Bernoulli lines in rational CFP. So let's consider perhaps the simplest unitary rational CFP, the 2D Eisen model. There are three primary operators, the identity operators, the energy operators, of weight 1/2 comma 1/2, and the spin field of weight 1/16. Each one of them will be associated to a line defect. The identity operator is associated to the trivial line, namely having no line at all. The energy operator will be associated to a line that I will denote by L epsilon. It's going to be a Z2 symmetry line. As we know, in the 2D Eisen CFT, the zero form global symmetry is Z2. The identity line and the L epsilon line already give you the two lines responsible for the Z2 global symmetry. But the fact that there's a third line means that this guy must be a non-symmetry line because we know the global symmetry is just Z2. And indeed, as we will see, this L sub sigma line is a non-symmetry. This is perhaps the simplest example of a non-symmetry line. So this is just a little table of the property of these three lines. the L epsilon is a Z2 line, the L sigma has VEF square root 2, which means that's a non-symmetry line. Essentially a duality defect, as I will explain later. So let's see how all these lines act on the local operators. Let's start with the easier L epsilon one.
Okay.
Yes, sorry.
Is there a way to tell which one it can be actually promoted to symmetry line, symmetry which is continuously broken, like using some object flow where?
One way to test whether the line is, first of all, if a line is, the VEF of the line is a protective quantity under renormalization flow. So if it starts its life as a symmetry line, then it will still be a symmetry line in the IR, and vice versa.
So there is no symmetry breaking?
There could be symmetry breaking in the quantum field theory, but that doesn't change the fact that it's still a symmetry line. Just like when the global symmetry is spontaneously broken, that doesn't mean the global symmetry is gone. It just means that the vacuum does not respect the symmetry. So for the same reason, when the symmetry is spontaneously broken, the topological lines are still perfectly good symmetry lines. It just acts non-trivially on your vacuum.
Right, but so if it's spontaneously broken, it acts, understood correctly what you said before, it acts non-trivially in the IR safety, but will act trivially in the UV safety.
When it's spontaneously broken, then right, it acts non-trivially on the IR vacuum, but it acts trivially on the UV vacuum.
Yes, well, that was my question. So here you have line which acts non-trivially in the CFT, and I was asking, is there a way to tell whether it can be promoted into, whether there is a RG flow such that this line becomes a spontaneously broken symmetry?
Oh, you want to ask whether it's easy to see whether if the line is spontaneously broken or not. I don't think there's an easy way, because all the property of topological lines are just about, in the case of symmetry lines, they only tell you whether it's anomalous or not. But that information alone, that information alone will not tell you whether the symmetry is broken or not. Like, if you have an anomalous global symmetry in the UV, in the IR it could be a gapless CFT where the symmetry is not broken, or it could be a gap base when the symmetry is broken. But from the line, the property of the line itself, you couldn't tell. That relies more on the interaction between the line and the local operators. That's really a dynamical problem, dynamical question. But in fact, the theorem I mentioned in the beginning is a little bit of that flavor. It's telling us that if a non-symmetry line is preserved, then the vacuum has to be, in some sense, spontaneously broken. But it's not a spontaneous breaking of a symmetry line. It's a quote-unquote spontaneous breaking of a non-symmetry line. That would be force on us, but I haven't explained it. So let's return to this symmetry Z2 line in the IC model, this L epsilon line. Let's study how it acts on local operators. First of all, the vacuum in the IC CFT is invariant under Z2 symmetry, so it acts trivially on the vacuum. The energy operator is invariant under the Z2 symmetry, so it leaves the energy operator invariant. And the spin field is odd, so there's a minus. The L epsilon acts on the operators, just like how the Z2 acts on the operators. That's the definition of L epsilon being a Z2 line. Now moving on to the non-symmetry line, L sigma. It acts on the vacuum by a square root 2, and it acts on the energy operator by a minus square root 2. But the most glaring difference between the L sigma and L epsilon is that it actually